Okay, we're back online, and we're not going to blame rural connectivity. I think it was an issue in Holyrood, but thank you very much for your patience. We've taken the decision to postpone the marine panel, which was due to start about 11:05. We are going to have more scope to scrutinise and ask questions of our terrestrial witnesses, which will be a bonus. So I'm going to go back to David was in the middle of answering a question on funding. And David, if you can recall where you are, we'll bring you back in, and then I'll move to questions from Alistair Allan.
That was a long time ago, Finlay. trying to remember what I was saying. I was in the middle of a rant about something. I honestly, can you remember what I was talking about?
Well, David, I could give you, I could give you something that was going to lead on from that to give you a start, and then we'll move to Alistair. We've talked about the additional cost that Rachel Hamilton touched on for organic and public procurement or whatever. But we're unlikely to see a cost reduction in food to the consumer. And we are seeing currently prices rising in agricultural inputs. So if we do try to transition, there's going to be quite a squeeze. Where's that funding going to come from? And what would the mechanism be for farmers like yourself to continue producing high-quality food and be profitable?
Well, we're actually just talking about that. We had our little private discussion off the event here, and what we found was that once we'd got our heads around organic, we could actually produce our milk for the same price. The organic guys don't like me saying this, but for the same price, we were producing milk at 24 pence a litre when our industrial neighbours were costing, it was costing them 28 pence. And we're looking now at the cost of labour going up dramatically. We're looking at the cost of fertilisers, probably pesticides, the whole thing, costs going up dramatically. And we're seeing the conventional price in the supermarket, the supermarkets are offering to farmers, rising quite markedly over the last 6 months. And I think that organic, you know, what we found was it wasn't the subsidy, it wasn't the extra premium we were getting from the market, because it was only five, at the farm gate, it was only between 5% and 10% on average that we were getting more than conventional. And the subsidy, we actually had our subsidy cut because we had to cut our numbers initially when we went organic. But it was the fact that our productivity of the farm after 10 years of being organic recovered, and we were carrying almost the same stock as we had when we were putting on all the fertilizers and pesticides, but we had driven out £40,000 of costs out of the system. And if you know, you look at fertilizer, and we were putting on 100 tons of fertilizers at fertilisers now at £750 a tonne. I mean, that's £75,000 alone. So we're now looking at a situation where I think to be sustainable, to be a sustainable, resilient business, you're going to have to go down the towards organic. I think a lot of the big estates, we were just talking about that again just a minute ago, in Fife are moving towards organic because they see the costs rising of their systems. These are arable and upland estates, and the costs are rising and the subsidies being reduced, and they are seeing that the way forward is to go organic, driving costs out of the system. And that is very much what we see. And in terms of resilience, in terms of you know, good for the environment, it has to be the way to go. Then, yeah, the costs. So the cost to the public, I don't think, should be significantly more than it is at the moment. It's about getting our heads around the system, learning how to do it properly, and getting our support mechanisms in place in terms of education, in terms of training, in terms of support. You know, we're talking about EECs. We are in an EEC scheme, and I asked the RSPB to come along and look at our EECs plan, because we were doing weighted graze grasslands and ponds and stuff. It took 2 years before anybody from RSPB arrived, by which time we had our plan in place. So we had no support. So as a farmer, okay, I'm willing. I wanted to do the thing right, but there was no support. There was no advice. There was no. So you end up just doing a plan that suits you. And of course, the other things in probably in the wrong place. So EECs is you know, it's well intended, but it's I don't think it will deliver the outcomes, because there is no support for farmers who don't understand what they're doing, like myself.
Thank you. And I'll move on to Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. You've mentioned some of the ways in which the public sector can support the kind of outcomes you're looking for in dairy farming, whether it's through subsidy or whether it's through public contracts for food. We've kind of touched on the issue of price, but I was interested to know your view about supermarkets, given that supermarkets exert, traditionally anyway, this huge influence over the price of milk. Where do supermarkets fit into this picture, or do they not fit into it? How do we ensure that supermarkets start to take these questions more seriously? You're on mute.
We've dealt with the supermarkets. We deal with the supermarkets at the moment. Their objective is to make money for the shareholders, not to for the suppliers. So it's about keeping the suppliers alive. But the supermarkets have direct. A lot of them have direct supply contracts, and these direct supply contracts are linked to the cost of production. So the supermarkets, they're almost a necessary evil, I think, and it's just making sure that they're held to account in terms of encouraging good standards of production. I think it comes back almost, because they'll only respond to one person, and that's the customer. And if the customer is demanding high quality food, produced in a proper, sustainable way, and that comes back again to education and to government to give the lead. Then the supermarkets will follow. You know, I think it, but it has to. The lead has to be made through public sector procurement. I'm very against subsidy. I think subsidies are so damaging, that dependency creating. I would get rid of subsidies tomorrow, and I would create the market through public sector. That's the way I would operate, and the supermarkets will follow, because if their customer is trained and educated and informed, which they're not at the moment, then the supermarkets will follow.
I'm not really disputing what you're saying about the importance of public contracts, but I'm just curious to know if you think there's anything that, meantime, the supermarkets should be doing that they're not doing just now.
They'll only move when their customers demand it. They're not going to do anything they don't have to do.
Okay.
Thank you. Just on that, do you believe that supermarkets respond to customer demand? Are we not in the situation in the UK where we have got some really big players in the supermarket sector who actually dictate? It's the supermarkets that put products on the shelf. It's not because there's a lack of choice. It's not consumer driven that sees food products on our shelf. It's the other way around. Is there not an issue with that? I'll leave that with you. I want to bring in Andrew, who'd like to touch on or respond to Andrew Alistair's point. So Andrew.
Yeah, just I hope I'm going to do justice to his words here, but when we were speaking in the group, I was counting a colleague of mine who's come to SRUC in the last few years from Denmark, and his perspective on the growth of organics in Denmark is very interesting, and I will hopefully do justice to what he said. The big things I took away from that were that in Denmark, organics was marketed and grew massively off the back of being the premium choice. You know, that's how it was pitched to consumers, and with the right support from farmers, growers, processors, retailers, it has become a significant market share in Denmark. The other point that he's made is he has been struck since he came to Scotland by the difference in attitudes to what government can do. I think his view, and I hope I'm not going to misrepresent him here, is that there's too much expectation on government here to pick up all the pieces for the sector or to do everything for the sector, but there's also not enough expectation on government here to intervene in at the retail end. In Denmark, the government sets rules and regulations, but is the farming sector isn't always asking government to take the lead on everything, but it does expect the government to properly regulate retailers and be more muscular in how it interacts with them. And I think there's something to be certainly looked at there. You know, I don't doubt that the retail sectors in the two countries will be different, but we seem to almost treat the retailers as something that we can't influence. You know, they're only influenced by this mystical thing called the consumer.
Thank you. Can I move to Ariane for the next set of questions, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to everybody for really great discussion so far. I think what I'm trying to understand are the blocks and the resistance to moving, you know, in the farming and cropping communities, to moving towards organic, regenerative, agroecology, so on and so forth. And what I'm kind of like picking up from this conversation and some other conversation I've had with this meeting is the kind of like the knowledge transfer needs to be there, the baselining. I think land ownership hasn't really come up yet in this conversation, but I'm aware of some things around like tenant farmers' short-term tenancies causes issues for your tree planting and things like that. And then also it's really beginning to strike me around farmer indebtedness, that some farmers are probably, you know, in debt to the current practices. So that's just a setup for a few questions I've got. You know, one is around regenerative farming practices and if they're currently taught in agricultural colleges. So, Andrew, you've talked about them, you know, your five farms, demonstration farms. But I'm really wondering if there is a need for an advisory service which would provide or arrange training and regenerative measures, and that one of its key responsibilities could be to support a just transition for the whole sector. I've been bringing this up quite a few times in the chamber and in conversations, and I just, what would that look like and how could we start going about it? And I know this is going to have to be a bit of a high level response probably. And maybe some of it needs to involve some of the baselining that you've mentioned earlier. And I think maybe we'll just start with Andrew, and then if anyone else wants to come in on that. Thanks, Michael.
Yeah, thank you. I think we should see if we can try and arrange to show you in more detail what's already happening, because there is a farm advisory service funded by Scottish Government. We deliver that. Regenerative agriculture is part of that. The current programme comes to an end at the end of March. Scottish Government is currently tendering for an additional 2 years. It's certainly our intention, if we are successful in winning the additional or the 2 years to come, that regenerative agriculture will be a significantly larger proportion of what we do alongside other biodiversity and climate change measures. So the advisory service is already looking at this, and as I said at the beginning, Farming for Better Climate through its regenerative agriculture focus farms is looking there. So that's another advisory service, extension service, that is examining this. And at the level of education, which I'm slightly less familiar with, it's other colleagues at SRUC's domain, but SRUC has a very long-standing organic trial set up near Craveston in Aberdeenshire, and I know I have colleagues, particularly people like Christine Watson, who have a really keen interest in organic agriculture and teaching that. I think it would be fair to say that in the past, it would be a less significant part of the curriculum, although there would be times in the past where it was more prominent. But I think it would also be fair to say that it is rapidly going up the agenda. And I would imagine that's not just at SRUC, I would imagine that is in many other places as well. But very happy to talk to you separately if you'd like more detail on this.
Thank you for that. And I think I saw Michael indicating that he would like to come in on that.
You started by saying, asking about blocks and resistance to, you know, mindset change. I think it's old habits. Old habits die hard. You know, we've had 40 or 50 years of CAP support, and people have got into a particular way of doing things, and it's very difficult, not easy for them to change that mindset, which is why I think we've all mentioned, haven't we, being on a journey. You know, this is a transition, and it will take time to get us onto this new mindset. What we haven't got, though, is time if we're going to address these emergencies. You know, they are genuine emergencies, and we've got to get on with it. So can I make a fairly radical suggestion in terms of knowledge transfer? We know through the network that the pilots that you funded of peer-to-peer learning, you know, farmer to farmer, get farmers out onto farms and get them to hear from other farmers, other crofters, what works. It's a very powerful way of driving a change in this mindset. So we would love in the network if you could support a big uplift in the KTIF fund. You know, at the moment it's little penny packets, and we know that you're open to bids for a much bigger contract, which of course we're not in a position to bid for. But there are a lot of farmers out there who are in the education system, some of them, you know, people, I won't mention names, but you probably know some of them. They're on AREOB and these kind of boards. You know, they are educators, they're also farmers, and they know the power of farmer to farmer, crofter to crofter, peer to peer learning. If I could also just touch on your point about tree planting, you know, we think this is there's an opportunity in the afforestation program, the afforestation budget, to do much more for agroforestry, which would be a big win, a big early win for our climate and biodiversity emergencies by supporting hedgerow creation. You know, agroforestry includes hedgerows. We would love to see more of that budget directed to hedgerow creation rather than the penny packets, frankly, that you have at the moment through the EECS scheme. Thank you.
Can I just ask, you talked about farmers and crofters coming together and knowledge transfer through that. On the back of Foot and Mouth, and particularly in the south of Scotland, in Dumfries and Galloway, there were groups set up, sector groups. So we had dairy farmers come together, beef farmers come together with some strange and wonderful names like the Cowboys or whatever. And as far as I'm aware, they were hugely successful. They were facilitated by consultants, and it was very much an open book process where farmers would sit round the kitchen table and discuss quite openly the challenges they had. Unfortunately, the funding for the facilitators fell away, and some of the groups fell by the wayside. Is that the sort of initiative you'd like to see brought forward? So funding from facilitators to pull together groups of farmers with a particular sectors? Michael?
So I used to work with people who are members of the Cowboy group. Great idea. Get farmers to talk. I think farmers are perhaps more able these days to talk amongst themselves without a facilitator. So facilitator might be helpful, but I think you'll find now, particularly with through networks like the Nature Friendly Farming Network, farmers are much more up for just talking to themselves about really getting behind this question that we had from Ariane about mindset change. You know, what are the blocks? Why are you not? You know, how come it works for you? Would it work for me? So it's that kind of, which is really quite soul searching and you know, bearing your soul in quite a sort of intimate way. And I think anything that helps that is to be encouraged. I think where facilitators would help, we think within the network where facilitators would help, would be in facilitating clusters farmers. For example, bringing farmers together to help upland waders, you know, working for waders, curlews, lapwings, these kind of things. So species-related biodiversity gain would be greatly facilitated by funding for facilitators to, you know, to bring farmers together, to get them to collaborate. You will know, as a farmer, that collaboration is not a Scottish or a British trait. You know, the French farmers collaborate so much more easily than we do. But I think we're in a new paradigm here now, and everybody realises we've got the pressure of these emergencies on us. We've got the pressure of costs, which you've talked about. We need to look hard, in a hard way, at our businesses, and we need to come up with a new business framework which works for us as businesses and also delivers for biodiversity and climate change.
Thank you. I'm going to go back to Tarianne for some further questions, then move on to Karen.
Thank you, Convener. So I just wanted to pick up on the bit about baselining. I'd love to hear from whomever on the panel. I'd like to understand that a bit more, because it does seem, in conversations I've had, again, out with this committee, that baselining is important. It's like we don't really know what's out there. We don't know what we're needing to track in terms of agriculture. And I'd just love to hear a little bit more about your thoughts on that. You know, what does that mean, and what do we need to actually be doing and pushing the government in the direction of, you know, making it more useful for farmers? Anybody want to have a go at that? Michael, thank you.
Well, thank you, Ariane. Thanks. I don't want to hog the floor here, but absolutely essential that we get this baseline. Andrew has mentioned AgriCalc, which is the SA Scottish Agricultural College calculator, which is what we used, which is what a lot of Scottish farmers use. And it's good as far as it goes. You know, it shows your emissions side of the equation. What it doesn't show is the sequestration side of the equation. So, you know how much you're pumping out, you know what you've got to go at, but you don't know how much you're managing to sequester on the farm. So what we need, I think, is a universally acceptable Scottish model, really, business, you know, a computer-based assessment that you can do on farm with an advisor. It probably takes an advisor to do it, that shows where you stand at the moment. Now, probably as an add-on to that would be a good idea if you did what Dee's been talking about, a natural capital inventory as well. So that's a sort of balance sheet. What I'm talking about is more sort of profit and loss, you know, where you are on a year from year by year basis. So we need quite a lot more work on that. And Andrew's probably a better place than me to say, but there may be a lot of research already and science going into that. But we definitely need urgently, we need something so that we're all starting from the same point. So we know, you know, we really know what we've got to do if we're going to achieve these targets by 2030 of nature positive, you know, and carbon net zero.
Andrew, can you come in the back for that, please?
We have a soil carbon module in AgriCalc. We have delayed the wholesale rollout of that because it is a significant subject of interest, and we know that if we don't get it right, quite frankly, we'll get crucified. That's why I made that comment earlier on about the fact that when people do start using it, in a lot of cases, they're going to be slightly disappointed with what they find, because the assumption is that they've all got, you know, more than enough carbon locked up in their soils to offset all the emissions. And actually what we find is that, you know, in most cases, on average, it's mid-teens to 20s. The baseline is absolutely important. We, AgriCalc SEC Consulting, is a significant piece of work. It draws in research colleagues from wider SRUC. The team is growing, interest in it is growing. I would say a couple of things. One, it's a calculator. It's a model, and therefore there's always a balance to be struck between the accuracy of the result and the usability of the tool. We can give you much more detailed result if you want, but it's going to be far less user-friendly. So we're trying to strike the balance. Our emphasis is probably more on the accuracy than the usability, but we are putting much more. We're overhauling the user interface at the moment. And the second thing I would say is, again, it's a farm-scale tool. it's designed to help farmers understand where they're at and make recommendations as to where they can go. It's not designed to model the entire country as one and reach big broad conclusions about the whole country. If everyone piles in and uses it, then we certainly get much more accurate results. Thousands of farmers have used it to date. We've got no doubt that something like the National Test Programme that was announced by the Cabinet Secretary a month or so ago will drive further use of this tool. But just to reiterate, the soil sequestration module is there. It will be there will be a sort of full-scale rollout of that in 2022, but we know we need to get it right. And soil carbon modelling is extremely complicated, and a very small error in input values can have a massive impact on the farm carbon footprint. So we really need to get it both as accurate as we can and as user-friendly as we can. And one of the ways that we'll achieve that is by linking AgriCalc to other data sets that sit out there, cattle tracing and various other things, so that we automate the data flow and thereby we minimise the risk of input error.
D-Ward, would you like to come in?
I think that we need this uniform methodology, and one of the challenges I think of moving anything forward is everyone agreeing that that is the correct methodology. I agree with Michael. I think we need to. It's not just about carbon; it's about wildlife and biodiversity, and it's about natural capital. I think we need to value that, and putting a value on things, as I said at the beginning, makes people respect them, because suddenly they have a value and, oh, I'm not going to go and cut that tree down because it has a value. And I think that's important. And unfortunately, as humans, we only really understand capital values, but at least it puts a value and we respect it. But I think that's good. Other examples are things like people can manage their wood from this baseline data. By managing your woods well, you'll be sequestering more carbon and have more biodiversity and natural wildlife and biodiversity. So, you know, people will be moving at different speeds. And I guess the other bit I wanted to touch on is just that additionality is another factor. There are people out there who are already doing fantastic jobs. I'm sure a lot of Michael's nature-friendly farmers are doing a brilliant job, and they've taken their farm from somewhere, you know, average to somewhere very good in terms of biodiversity and wildlife and natural capital. And I don't think they should be left behind because they're already doing good things. So we have to have a mechanism that picks up the good work people have already done, and it also encourages those behind to improve. That needs to cover both, because it'd be terrible to penalise people who are already doing a good job.
David? That's David there.
Yes, I agree with Michael and Dee Pence. I would add, well, we used AgriCalc a couple of years ago, and I was very disappointed that it did not include sequestration of any sort. So we've planted 35,000 broadleaf trees on the farm. They weren't included. Soil sequestration wasn't included. All the savings that we'd made in cutting down on our anthelmintics and antibiotics and so on, not included because not considered to be significant. My concern, as Dee just mentioned, is that if we focus too much on baselines, then the people who have been abusing their land and environment are the major beneficiaries, and those who have been healing the land and improving the environment are the least beneficiaries of an incentive scheme. So we have to be very careful. I'd rather see benchmarking as opposed to baselining.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions from Karen.
I'd like to ask, I've heard the word collaborative a few times now. This is perhaps maybe in a different context. But one of the issues which often comes up when I speak to farmers are the issues around new and more advanced machinery being incredibly weighty, if that's a correct term. And also when, you know, for example, when they're adapting or convert into hydrogen. This can add significant extra tonnage for the physical adaptations. So where we are advancing on greener and smarter machinery, we could be causing significant soil disruption. So can I ask if you work collaboratively with other industries to help inform these innovative ideas to limit or at least to ensure that these types of unintended consequences are considered?
Let me kick off with you, Dee.
That's a good question. What we try and do, so everything, so I can only speak personally, I guess, on this and for Wildlife Estates members as well. But typically what we do is we just experiment with stuff and we see what works and what doesn't. And like all of this, it's not an exact science. It's a bit of a learning curve. For us, I mean, talking about compaction and heavy equipment, we're looking at making our fields smaller, having more hedgerows around them, and using smaller equipment. And I've worked out that actually, this isn't the case for all farming, by the way, but in a lot of livestock farming, often you don't need, or sheep farming like I do, you don't need big bits of equipment. You can do it with small bits of equipment, and actually you probably get more, it's less impactful on the planet if you do use small bits of equipment, if you see what I mean. So that's only, sorry, it's probably not a good answer, but that's my own experience on it.
And Andrew.
Just to say that the hydrogen kit that I've seen fitted on tractors I saw just a few weeks ago up in Aberdeenshire wasn't particularly large. I can't say that every single bit of kit will be the same as that, but certainly I wouldn't particularly be concerned about the impact given what proportion of the total weight of that equipment it was. I think there's definitely been a disconnect between the desire to maximise the top line and push for yield and output and simplification of farms, and on the other side, more resilient farms, slightly inverted commas, messier farms, more hedges, more margins, all that kind of stuff. There's definitely something there, but I think in an arable setting, certainly been a high degree of innovation and maybe bolting a few more bits of kit onto one tractor and doing one pass through the field versus multiple passes. You know, I'm not an expert on on soil compaction, but there'll be trade-offs in both of those scenarios. But I think what we do need to do is move to systems that are more resilient. So at the start I spoke about what the regenerative agriculture group is doing around cover crops and all sorts of other things that can minimise soil erosion and keep the ground in better condition. I think we definitely need to be looking at more innovative ways to manage our soils rather than saying, well, we're just going to run the largest bit of kit we can over at once, because as the climate gets more extreme, the risks to soil grow very significantly.
Thank you. Any further questions, Karen? No, I'll move on to questions from Jenny Minto.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel. This has been I've found this really, really informative, so thank you very much for your time. I was struck when Andrew mentioned the Danish example and experiences from his colleague from Denmark. It brought to mind a visit that I had to Sweden, where, again, there was very much emphasis on local produce in supermarkets, so kind of tying into Dr. Allen's question. And there was a farmer there who had his cattle, he had a butcher, he was supplying the school, so a lot of local connections. So I'm just interested in the panel's thoughts about links with schools, links with your own communities, how we keep the produce local but still go out to a wider market. And also, I'm very aware, representing a constituency that's rural, remote, rural and islands, how these your ways of working, how they can be replicated in areas like that, because I think it's fair to say that one size doesn't doesn't necessarily fit all, but you can take benefits, because I know there's a farmer, Michael, on Lismore that's doing a lot of regenerative work as well. So it's how we can ensure that your messages get out, and maybe people don't take them all lock, stock and barrel. They take bits, elements that will work in their areas. So I'm not terribly sure what my question is there, but certainly I'd just like to get your thoughts, please.
D Ward.
Yes, thank you. I think there's very good points you've brought up there. We need to change attitudes, and they are, funnily enough, they are changing. I think, funnily enough, COVID has made a big difference, because people have started buying locally, wanting locally produced, and then there's the whole environmental part of it. But I do think, you know, we need to understand the true value of food production. So, you know, locally produced, healthy, low environmental impact. You're not offshoring your CO2 by buying something from somewhere else. And for all of that, it needs education. And I think education of people is key. But people are beginning to get that message. We, for example, at home, we've through the Scottish Land Matching Service, I've set up a joint venture with a French gentleman who lives in Scotland. He was at Pillars of Hercules down in Fife, and he grows vegetables, and we do vegetable boxes now. And it's something we've started, and we've only got four small polytunnels, but it's, you know, that there are huge opportunities to produce locally, and we've set up a little shop which is only open once at the weekend. But then I've suddenly thought, well, I can probably sell my lamb and my venison and other things through that shop and make a lot more money per lamb than sending it off somewhere. So I think that there is a real opportunity if we get people's heads around it and they understand the true cost of production and how. I mean, I read a stat somewhere that a carrot produced 50 years ago was X times more healthy than the carrot today, had more nutrients in it. So actually, when you look at delivering really good quality food, it's actually not expensive when you take into account what the nutrients value you're getting out of it. But I think there's a huge opportunity there. The other thing with it, it gets people out and about. They go for a walk and they come out and see these places rather than just going to a supermarket or whatever. So I do think there's a really big opportunity around that, definitely.
Andrew would like to come in.
Of going to Norway a few years ago, one of the things I was most struck by was the effort and the investment that was put into their equivalent of Open Farm Sunday or Royal Highland Educational Trust. It was exponentially larger than here. It was massive, and every single local community had somebody whose responsibility it was to keep that going in the farming community. And I know that people involved in Open Farm Sunday and RET do a great job, but we are nowhere near the scale we need to re-engage people with what goes on in farms and estates and crofts. The other thing I would say is, I'm not sure how to do this, but we've really got to try and change the narrative about farming in a lot of the media, because it's really alienating. The sort of constant headlines about farmers being, you know, sort of criminally responsible almost for climate change, it's counterproductive. I'm not disagreeing with some of the science, full stop, behind it, but you're never going to get anyone on side if the headlines are constantly negative. And I find a lot of farmers who just shut down to the entire change agenda, never mind climate change, just change full stop, because they feel constantly under attack. So I think we've all got a collective obligation to do more to put out there both the good and the bad in a balanced way.
Thank you, Jay.
Thank you, Andrew, for that. I think you've made a very important point there. I just wondered, David or Michael, have you got anything to add to what's been made in connection to what I was asking?
Thank you, Jenny. Yes, I have. If I can go first, David. We're on the case. We're plumbed into Nourish Scotland. You know, we're very attuned to Oh dear, can you still hear me?
Yep.
I know you can, David. Can everybody else?
Yes, yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, good. Sorry, we lost the picture. we think it's very much the direction of travel, isn't it? You know, we've an immense amount to do to catch up. But my vice chair was Lynn Castles of Lynbrett Croft. You probably have heard of Lynbrett Croft. You know, and that is their business model. You know, they've got food clubs. They supply local people with eggs and with beef. And it's this whole provenance. You know, people are much more concerned about where their food comes from. And they're telling their story in ways which are, you know, people want to hear. And so I think we are going to see so much more of it. And I think the kind of message I and we within the network are trying to get out to people who have maybe larger land holdings. Why don't you give these guys a chance? You know, I've got 300 acres here. We've heard about these farms in Fife, you know, people, members of our steering group, they've got thousands of acres, some of them. If you can make even 5 or 10 acres available to people with the kind of mindset you're talking about, you know, we will see a naissance of this kind of local food opportunity, reducing food miles and giving Scottish people affordable, nutrient-dense food, which is, after all, isn't it, a basic human right.
Thank you, Michael, for that. If I may, just a very quick supplementary. You mentioned hedgerow creation, and I was thinking back to when I was growing up and we would go for walks, and the way that you got round farms was walking along the side of a hedge. And so we haven't really touched very much on biodiversity. So I'm interested to know your thoughts about how we encourage hedgerow back.
Oh, I would love that. I'm an absolute hedgerow nerd. Since I plant 1,000 metres of new hedge personally here every year, so I have to double fence the stuff and plant 7 plants per metre. So if you can work that out, you know, that's 7,000 plants I personally stick in the ground every year. And it's a real wow situation. I can't tell you, you know, how exciting it is to stand beside hedges we planted. We've been here 13 years. We bought it 13 years ago. Hedges, now I'm 6'4". These are twice my height, you know, and they're bursting with berries. And they're full of birds and bees and butterflies, and they're great shelter for wildlife. You know, they're great for biodiversity. They're great in terms of, you know, the wind here in the southwest of Scotland blows, you can imagine. I think maybe as much as it blows up at Lismore, you know. So they're great shelter for livestock. They would do an immense amount to sequester more carbon. I don't have the research to hand, but I think there is research that says that hedges sequester twice as much carbon as woodland. You know, and that's a pretty powerful statistic, probably because of the density of hedges. And there, you know, CPRE in England have got a major hedgerow increase programme. It would be wonderful if we could do something like that in Scotland. It would make so much difference to the appearance of the landscape, because what we need urgently, isn't it, is transformational change on a landscape scale. And what I think all four of us talking to you today are keen to see is these dots joined up, to see much more collaboration, you know, between farmers, landowners, land managers, the public sector, the private sector, all with a shared vision of a beautiful, bountiful Scotland, which we can achieve if we all work together.
Jenny, if you don't mind, I'm going to butt in there. I'm a bit of a hedge fan as well. And I've been involved in laying hedges and whatever in the past. But we're talking about an emergency here. Still, sadly, whilst the vast majority of farmers are great custodians, we still have farmers who are set on ripping out hedges to make it easier for big machinery to get in to cut grass, whatever. And we see it on a daily basis. Is now the time for the government to take action and put in new legislation to stop that happening? Because the financial penalties in removing hedges don't appear to make any difference. Is there an argument, and this will be controversial, and I will repeat, it's a small minority of farmers that are continuing this, but given the biodiversity and climate change emergency, should we see the rapid introduction of legislation that stops the destruction of habitats, whether it's hedges or whether it's ponds or whatever. So, Michael, just if you carry on from where you were, what's your position on legislation to ensure we don't see removal of habitats.
Right, thank you, Convener. The network doesn't shy away from controversy. We take your position on this. If, for goodness sake, you know, if we're in a bad place here, and we've got to get ourselves in a better place pretty damn quick. And so, yes, I think there is a case for legislation, if it comes to that, you know, to stop people destroying what little we have got left, frankly. You know, there have been cases, haven't there, of farmers removing dikes and things. You know, and these dikes have been there for hundreds of years. They're part of our national heritage. And, you know, to destroy them is vandalism, frankly. And hedges come in under that category too. Yeah, I think if it comes to that, then something to stop that is something that we, and I certainly personally, would very much support. But what, as I've said at the outset, what we're trying to do here is to get into the mindset of these people by, you know, and showing them that they're wrong to do that. That's the wrong thing. It doesn't help their businesses. It's actually a bad business decision to remove a hedge, because you're focusing, as we've said, you know, at length this morning, on the top line, on the yield, and not the bottom line, the profitability, you know, what's left in terms of value to your business. And your contribution as a custodian of the countryside, whether you're a tenant or a landowner, a custodian of our planet, because there ain't no planet B, you know, and we've only got 9 years or whatever it is to turn the situation and make us carbon, you know, getting on the right track so that we're on the uptick towards carbon net zero and nature positive.
Can I ask David the same question? Because you did, I picked up on your point about baselining, and that baselining is probably not the way to go forward, because it potentially, the funding could go to people who have just not done the right thing in the past, and it doesn't recognise those who have paid particular attention to the role that biodiversity plays in agriculture. So what's your opinion on how we tackle the continuing, on a very small scale, but the removal of dikes and hedges and whatever? How would you like to see that approached in the very short term, given we're in a biodiversity emergency?
Well, as you know, Finlay, we come from an area which has one of the highest and most intensive dairy sectors in the UK, and that, you know, the dairies are big. The average dairy size in this part of the world is over 400 cows now, and very few of them get outside. The situation, I mean, all these things are joined together. We've got we're always moving towards higher technology. I was talking to the tractor supplier the other day, and he was saying how a tractor nowadays is a £60,000 piece of equipment with £60,000 of technology on it. When you're spending £100,000 or £200,000 on a piece of technology, you have to make it work. And so we're moving into scale, and scale. So scale is very important here, because scale brings economies, and that allows cheap food to be produced. And cheap food is the objective of all governments and supermarkets. So we've got the price driver driving scale, which drives technology, which drives the need for bigger fields, and that tears out the hedges. You know, we can't put a £200,000 tractor in a 10-acre field. It just doesn't work. So you just look around here and you see hedges coming out. You see wetland habitats being drained and filled in, and it's happening now, still happening. And how do you get away from that? It has to be stopped. You say yourself, we're in an emergency. This is an emergency. We've got to treat it like an emergency. But so, Andrew says we have to be careful not to get too dependent on government action. But how else do you stop this? Because it's being driven by the economy. It's being driven by the economic factors, and everything is joined up. It comes back from the customer, the supermarket, the farmer and the technologies that he has to employ to deliver what's required. So the only way you're going to stop it is through legislation.
Thank you. And Andrew?
I would like to go back to some of the things I said at the start about language. You know, I was on a farm recently, and there was a massive hedge on that farm, and the farmer was really proud of it. But one of the other people there was talking about messy hedges. And you hear that a lot of times when people are talking about landscape features. Oh, we, you know, there's nothing better than a nice, neat farm. You know, we've really got a job here to change what is valued, change the language that we use, because actually that messy farm is the one that's potentially got more space for biodiversity, and that nice, neat, rationalised agricultural unit that can take a massive tractor is a factory in the countryside, and it's doing a very good job, and it's being driven by economics, and it's responding to signals that market and government policy have given it for years. But alongside these harder things like regulation, we also need to change the lexicon that we use here. That's really, really important. We've got to talk about resilience and margin rather than performance and output.
D, go ahead.
Oh, sorry, I didn't hear you call me in. Apologies. Yeah, just on the hedges thing, well, on most things, I'm a great believer in the carrot and the stick. I think that people are motivated, they don't want to do wrong and they don't want to get penalised, but ultimately, if they see a benefit for doing it, I think that is what helps. So I'm all in favour of legislation, but I think we need to take people on our journey with us, and we need to encourage them to do the right thing. And I think some sort of a carrot always helps that. Going to the point about people pulling out hedges because they've got big kit and so on, and they can't get them into the fields and they need to produce cheap food. To me, it's not cheap if you pulled out a hedge. And I think we need to get away from this whole mindset that it's cheap. Cheap, we need to factor in the whole cost of producing that food. And if there's environmental damage, it's suddenly very expensive food. And we need to learn and respect food. If it was more expensive, people would probably not waste it, and so on. There's a huge, we really need to get people to respect the fact that good quality food will cost a price, but it will be nutritious for you, and you won't need to waste any of it. And I think that's a really important message too.
Thank you. That's really useful. A lot of these policies, what we've discussed, is about local procurement, local food production, reducing food miles and so on. And we do have the Good Food Nation Bill coming up, which it is pretty empty, but there is scope there for it to hopefully deliver some of the expectations of stakeholders. Do we need more funding at local level to drive local policies? So more funding devolved to local authorities and public bodies to address the priorities. So, for example, in whether it's the Highlands or Dumfries and Galloway, the Scottish borders. Do we need to change the method of funding to ensure that our aspirations for reducing food miles is addressed? Andrew, can I ask you to comment, please?
Yeah, I think the bringing together of people that's already been spoken in these one to few groups is evidence that if you bring together people with a common interest close to where they are, you're going to get a high degree of buy-in. I can't speak to the efficiencies of channeling more funding through more regional or local routes, but I certainly know that when we engage people on a subject, if we make it local and we make it relevant and we have their peers around them, then we get more traction. Something broadcast from the centre will tend to attract quite often a particular type of person in a particular type of situation. More local procurement, local initiatives are certainly something that we are seeing, and we are involved in a number of them. And you know, there are groups like Opportunity North East and South Scotland Enterprise that are certainly making or putting a lot of effort in this area at the moment. And you know, we are involved in a number of them as well.
Thank you. And Dee.
Yeah. So I actually think that a lot of improvements will be made by some more market-driven things. Things like local abattoirs that's been talked about before. So we're not moving stuff a long way to go through the food chain, and local markets. And the other thing is, which the government can be involved in, it's picking up on a point made earlier about Denmark. Why not force supermarkets to buy quite a big percentage of their stuff that's locally produced, and throwing a real curveball in there? Where we've gone for a minimum price in alcohol, why not go for a minimum price for some prices they have to pay, supermarkets have to pay, to the local suppliers as well? So those sort of things would have a direct impact and benefit, I think.
Okay, I'm going to move to Rachel Hamilton for a question.
It's to ask the panel whether they believe that the £51 million allocated from next spring, over the next 3 years from spring, for the national test programme will be enough to ensure that farmers and crofters and land managers have the ability to transition and increase biodiversity and reduce emissions.
Andrew, would you like to come in on that first?
Sure. I think it's a very welcome start, and the observation I've made to people is that the sort of ecosystem to support that transition needs time to grow as well. There are lots of networks out there, the Nature Friendly Farming Network. There are organisations like mine who can support this, but that change of focus will take a bit of time, and we are in the process of recruiting people with different skill sets in order to support that. So I think it's a good start. I think it's part of the journey. I'm not sure I would necessarily advocate, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 times more money going in, straight away, because everyone needs time to get their head around what this looks like, and then the support structures need time to be realigned and start supporting that work. So yeah, a step in the right direction, absolutely. But I've got no doubt that more will be needed in the fullness of time.
Will SAC be the recipient of that money that would then advise farmers how to move forward to meet net zero?
I think there's a lot of details still to be worked out in there. We would be one party in this. We would certainly not be the only people advising on this. I've got no doubt that lots of other groups will be involved in that, but we will be an active and constructive partner for anything that we're asked to get involved with.
And
is there anyone else?
Is there anybody else like to comment on that? Have I got anybody indicating? No. Jim Fairley's got a question.
Look,
oh, beg your pardon.
Up.
I see Michael Clark's indicating. Yeah. Michael, would you like to come in?
Rachel, to answer your question, no. Don't think it is enough. It's a lot of money, though, isn't it? And I think it's a question of how it's distributed. If we want to boost biodiversity, we need a direct and close link to biodiversity in terms of, you know, the way the money's spent. I think the most recent scheme had some pretty tenuous links. Some of the objectives, you know, the capital grant scheme that was available, you know, it was some things like you can get a cattle handling system because that might make your, you know, make you more efficient. You know, the link, but there's obviously a health and safety basis for that. But I'm not sure that public money that helps a business for really what are direct, you know, only business related objectives is the best way to spend public money in this emergency, when we are looking to address a biodiversity and climate change crisis. So if I could say on behalf of the network, if you have any influence in how that money is spent, then please, if we could make sure that it goes towards, you know, measures that have a close and direct link to boosting biodiversity. Otherwise, we just ain't going to get there. You know, we're not going to make the targets that we are setting ourselves. Thank you.
David, did you want to come in the back of that question?
Well, thanks. The problem that we faced when we were applying for our EECs was that we didn't understand, you know, we're willing enough, we're farmers, we're trained as farmers, we think farming, were willing to convert to a more biodiverse way of farming, but there's so limited support. Help us to do the right things. And that is, as Michael's just said, you know, we need to be doing the right things rather than doing what we think is right, and they can be quite different. So we need support, we need help, we need an infrastructure to give us the right advice at the right time.
Thank you. I'm now going to move on to Jim and then Ariane.
Thanks, Convener. I have to say, guys, I have loved this conversation today, but somebody who has just come out of farming and into politics, I should maybe be back out in the field. However, and I love the warm, fuzzy glow that we've got, that we're all talking about the really good things we could do and all the rest of it. But having been through this process for over 20 years, we're trying to link public procurement to local food networks. We coined the phrase buy local, eat local almost 20 years ago. It's great, and I get it. I really do. But public procurement spend in Scotland is worth between 150 to 180 million, half of which is spent on Scottish produce. The Scottish farm budget at the moment is about 540 million, and the Scottish government has a fixed budget, which will be determined by what the UK agricultural policy then turns out to be going forward. Supermarket sales of food alone in this country are £12 billion. And if you add the pub and restaurant sector, there's another £10 billion being spent there. I love what we're talking about. I'd love to see it happen. But the reality of those figures demonstrates that we're actually just tinkering around the edges. So where do you see us getting this into the mainstream? Michael, I see you nodding your head.
I wish I had the answer, Jim. I'm nodding because I agree with you. I agree with your analysis. It is very difficult, isn't it? My past life, you know, I've been involved with big business that has supplied catering sector and I suppose supply, not actually supplied supermarkets, but well, I think the answer is there's a change. You know, things have changed. There is a in the industry, you know, which you've recently left and which I'm very privileged to still be part of, and I'll hang on to as long as I can till they carry me out in a box. You know, there are new people coming through. There are new entrants, and what we've got to make sure is that these guys, and a lot of them are women, because women are driving a lot of this nature-friendly farming change in the industry. So it's an interesting kind of analysis, I suppose, in itself. But, you know, they want to do this kind of thing. They are mothers. They take their children to school. They're going to ask, why are they not, you know, buying more local produce? So I think the public sector needs to set a better example, and that will feed through into the schools, and people will start to ask these questions about where does the food come from? Is it coming from Scottish farmers? Are they local? You know, I think there is a movement towards this. But what we've got to also make sure is that this corporate invasion, which we've touched on, into the countryside, you know, driven by the carbon credits they think they can get by buying up farms and planting up new trees in the wrong places for the wrong reasons, you know, doesn't exclude, and that's a big risk, it's happening at the moment, exclude these new entrants, like you were, like I was, you know, all those years ago, the opportunity to get in and really take the risk and grow vegetables, produce meat, hopefully with a better local abattoir network, if we can, you know, manage to get that in. But I think we will find from a bottom-up approach rather than a top-down approach here, if you can support it, that this is much more likely to happen. And I think, and I hope I'm right, but if you look back in 10 years' time, I think we will see, you know, there'll be a groundswell of this kind of thing, many more Lynbrett Crofts and these sort of places across Scotland supplying local people who want to buy local food because they're interested in where it comes from and how it's been produced.
Can I ask David to comment and then Dee?
We process all our milk pretty well on the farm here into ice cream and cheese. The cheese really gives us access to a UK market, and the reason we've gone down the cheese route was to get access to a UK market. because we can sell online and we can deliver next day anywhere in the UK. Local people do buy our cheese, there's no question, but it's never going to be, because it's artisan, it's small scale, it's about scale. Unless the price on the shelf of local food is close to the large-scale products that are being presented, certainly in these poorer areas, like Dumfries and Galway, Highlands and Islands, I guess, people aren't going to buy it because they don't have the budget. Our meat, even the lambs and cattle from the farm, they go through butchers to the Central Belt and London, and probably 75% of what we produce on the farm goes inside the M25. Is that local? I don't know. It's UK. It's competing with probably French, so hey, that must be good. But it to be able to get your product onto the shelf, compete with the big guys, and the supermarkets won't touch us because we're too expensive. Then you have to have a processor who is dealing with that at scale, because artisan food is just too expensive. I don't know if that helps at all, Jim.
Just reconfirms my fears that that this is an uphill battle, and particularly given the fact that supermarkets, I agree with Finlay, supermarkets will determine what we're going to have. They give us all the promises that, yep, we're all about giving people choice, and they will give people choice, but people will make a six-second decision when they walk into a supermarket from the time they look at it to the time they put it in their basket. And the first thing they'll look at is price. We have to absolutely change the culture before we're going to get this wonderful, warm feeling that we've got in here out into the public domain. And I'm not saying that to be negative. I'm saying that's the challenge that we face. I'm also going to come back very quickly on one point that Finlay made earlier on. And that is, we've got to give proper recognition. And it's something that you said as well, David. We've got to give proper recognition to the farmers who are doing it to a level just now, which is already, and what you call regenerative, it's not. It's old-fashioned farming. I mean, I planted 2,500 metres of hedging because I wanted shelter belts. Their stuff has already been done, and we need to take cognizance of that rather than starting at the bottom and try to bring everything up. The ones that are at the bottom should be brought up to the level of where we currently are on the baseline of whatever an area, because one size doesn't fit all. Whether you're living in the west or you're living in the south or you're living in Fife or Perthshire, there will be a baseline for that area. What's it like in that area? And then how do we bring everybody else to that standard as we go up? And it's hugely complicated, but I'm thoroughly enjoying the conversation.
Can I come in?
Yep, certainly.
Please. My response to the supermarkets, yes, absolutely. The supermarkets want to put on the shelf the products that give them the most profit margin. That's the bottom line. But, and it's interesting because we've seen a change in the dairy industry recently where one of the supermarket chains, and I think others are following suit, and a milk processor have insisted. And this is a result of deep discomfort with their customers on how bull calves were being treated on dairy farms. And they are now insisting that their suppliers do not cull bull calves on farm, that all bull calves have to be raised to at least 8 weeks, which gives them value and therefore means that they will enter the food chain in due course. Otherwise, they cannot supply them with milk. And that so that has come about from pressure from the customer, which relates back to probably vegan activism and the BBC's Panorama programme, The Dark Side of Dairy, a couple of years ago. So pressure, you know, it's not all supermarket.
Very, very briefly.
I'll be very brief. And this was something I wanted to ask you earlier on. What kind of bull are you using to get your... Because you're keeping the calves on the cow. So what kind of bull are you using?
I mean, Angus.
Angus.
Thank you. That was nice and short. Ariane.
Thank you, Convener. I think I've probably got a question that will procure a very short answer. But I'd love to know whether any of the witnesses have looked at the draft national planning framework, which was published earlier this month. And if so, if you've any thoughts about how well it will deliver on the stated purpose to manage the development and use of land and the long-term public interest and its stated aims to tackle and adapt climate change and restore biodiversity loss. And I believe that farming to some degree is missing from the picture. So if you have had a chance to look at it, it is a bit of a tome. And if you haven't had a look at it, I'd love to hear from you in the future about your perspectives on it.
Nobody's bidding.
Nobody's looked at it.
Michael.
Thank you for the heads up. Thank you. We'll get on to that. It's not something you immediately think of, isn't it? Is it when you're thinking about the future for farming industry? But we're very plumbed into regional land use partnerships. I think we hold a lot of that's what we hold on to in terms of the discussion we've been having this morning, really, about trees in the right place for the right reasons, and farming and how does it fit. So thank you for that. And yes, farming's going to have to, I think, probably up its game, to properly stand its corner in what is becoming an increasingly interesting debate, isn't it, about the future of land use in Scotland. And land use is really at the key of all we've been talking about, isn't it? And, land rights and responsibility statement, all that stuff, very much on our radar. And now thank you for the heads up. That'll be on our radar too. We'll make sure we respond to that too.
Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, as a convener, I always get the privilege of the last question. Well, generally, we've got a consultation out on the replacement for CARP. It was launched in August, and it's expected to be published in the spring in 2022. Johnny Holth then, if you has quite rightly said, it's a defining moment for the future of Scottish agriculture, and business as usual cannot be an option. But we need something that where farmers and crofters, regardless of size or type, will play their role in food production, but also their part in climate change and biodiversity emergencies. We've just heard the eye-watering figures from Jim Fairley on the value of the food and drink industry, and we're just touching the edges when it comes to funding. So finally, and I'm going to go to everybody, can you give me your hopes, your aspirations and your fears over what the future agricultural rural support might be to replace CAP? And I will start with Andrew, and then Michael, D, and then finish with David.
My hope would be that we send clear, consistent and sufficiently ambitious signals to all the parties that need to get them, whether that be farmers and crofters, supermarkets, policymakers, whoever. My fear is that in our natural human desire to protect one another, we don't face up to the fact that actually this requires a degree of disruption in order to be achieved, and therefore the sector cannot stay as it is, and it cannot transition over decades and decades and decades. This needs to be more rapid. So we've got to be careful that we don't kill the sector with kindness here.
Thank you.
There needs to be a balance struck.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Convener. And thank you for listening to us today. We have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity here, don't we? Johnny's quite right to flag that up. What we need is transformational change at a landscape scale. Individual farmers changing, which is what we're trying to achieve, is really like postage stamps, stuck across the countryside. We need to get ways of farmers to collaborate here, don't we? We all need to pull together on this. And we would like to see support, as I've said this morning, for things like agroforestry, for agroecology, for some of the specific suggestions I've made. And I think we mustn't shy away, must we, from a degree of turnover in this industry. You know, I'm the old guy here. There are other younger options are available within the network, I can assure you. You know, we need to get young blood in. And if that means that people who can't really get their heads around the new mindset that we need, the back to basics that Jim's talked about, you know, the way we used to do it, the way we look at the countryside in a holistic way, can't get their minds around that, then they need to be encouraged probably to move aside and let new blood come in that get the picture, because they are the people who are going to inherit the situation that we're all desperately trying to sort.
Thank you, Michael. And Dee?
Thank you. I guess that my hope for the new CAP would be that it's much more focused on net biodiversity gain and sustainability. We do need to remember that we still have to produce food for a nation, but we need to do it sustainably, and in my opinion, that can be done. I think we need to have the funding that reflects that. And I think my fear would be, my other thing is that, and that starts soon. I don't want to wait years for that to go in. I think we need to start the changes for that quickly, even if it's incremental changes over the next 2 or 3 years to get us ready for, you know, the quicker the better, as I see it. And my fear is there'll be no or little change from the existing system, and the can gets kicked down the road, because I think that would be really detrimental to the climate change crisis.
Thank you. And last but not least, David.
Well, I've probably touched on it already. We have a crisis. We need change in the industry, and everyone's talked about this already. The industry is not going to be happy to change, but it's going to have to be forced to change. I agree with Dee or Michael, who said that there's carrots and sticks, and these can be used to incentivize change or incentivize people to get out who are not going to change. And I think that the incentive has to come through initially through government, because nothing else is going to change quickly enough. Here is the opportunity. So government has to be brave, has to be proactive, and it has to implement unpleasant, change in our industry.
Thank you very much. And that brings us to conclusion. I'd just like to thank you all very much for your very useful, interesting and thought-provoking contributions. I think I share the views of the committee. It's been very, very useful this morning. Once again, apologies for the glitches we had, and thank you for your patience. And we certainly ran over time with you. We could probably speak for another hour. But thank you all very much, and I draw this meeting to a close.